I think we'll begin, and if people come in, they'll just join us. You know, on the airlines, they say, they announce what flight it is and where it's going, and if you're on the wrong flight, you should get off the plane. So this is the course on Utopia. Is everybody here correctly? Anyone had different expectations? Okay, so we're on the same page as you people say, young people say.
We're headed for Utopia.
It's a long way. I think we have the right questions, but it's a long way to the finishing line, and I won't be around for it. So I'll be around for the dystopia part of the Utopia. I'm not going to give a long introduction. We're going to be looking at two books which have been supplied to us courtesy of the library. We'll be looking at Thomas More's Utopia and Dostoevsky's Notes from Underground. It may be a source of perplexity what Dostoevsky has to do with all this. But in fact, the Notes from Underground, I think it's my opinion, my impression, it's probably the most compelling argument against the idea of utopia. And you'll judge for yourself, but pretty effectively compressed in a small number of pages, he gets the heart of the problem of trying to construct a utopia. On the other hand, Moore, I find, raises all the right questions. Whether he has the right answers will be for you to judge. But the questions are, in my opinion, after many decades, not just years, pondering it, the issues, I find that he raises the questions, and they're the right ones, you know, trying to figure out how you create a more decent society. And also, I think that Moore is more relevant now than, okay, he's not more relevant than people like Marx, but he raises questions which I feel Marx doesn't. In terms of our own world with finite resources, finite capacity to meet human needs, how do you create a society in which you distribute resources and we don't end up destroying ourselves in this coveting of more and more and more, in that case not being Thomas More. So I think he raises questions which I've never found a satisfactory resolution in the work of Marx and his successors, because they always start on the assumption that the productive power of capitalism and modern so-called means of production is so great that it can meet any of our needs. But I don't think that assumption is valid anymore. And I think that Moore raises the right questions. Just let me say a few things about the books. I had a choice between I hope you didn't get a divorce between Monday and Wednesday.
Did we not?
Okay. All right, that would have been very, very painful. I would have felt personally responsible.
I would have held you personally responsible.
I deserved it for what I said. With the Moore text, I had a choice between a dumbed-down modern version or a pretty tough old English version. I had taught in the past the modern version, and it read like a comic book. I couldn't really. Did I teach it with you? The very simple version, right? Yeah, and it just was too dumbed down. It was like more for idiots. And this version is actually from 1551. It's the first English translation. Originally it was in Latin. Moore wrote it in Latin. It's the first English translation. It's very tough. It gives me a headache reading it, and I've read it many times. But I don't think that should deter us, and I'll be very disappointed if people drop the class because of the language. We're going to make a determined effort, and my experience is if we work together, it'll become accessible to you. Now, that doesn't mean you're going to understand every word. I don't understand every word, but it's like reading Shakespeare. You have a choice between a dumbed-down version of Hamlet, should I or shouldn't I, or you do to be or not, you know. I still don't understand every word of Hamlet, and I still have to go up and down looking at the editor's notes, you know. But I think it's worth the effort, and we're going to do it together, and I think you'll discover some of the language is just really tremendous. It's really... it's exhilarating language. It is. I know you're laughing, but when you teach a great thinker, it's not just content. It really is the form also. The form is part of the content. This kind of meticulousness of expression, and it's just really nice. And I didn't want you to miss out on that aspect of the book. As it happens, last night, at the very end of the night, I'm about to go to sleep. I said, all right, let me look at the latest issue of the London Review of Books, a subscription to which I have courtesy of my friend Maren, who was determined to try to turn me into an intellectual. She said, it's just kind of embarrassing that you teach these courses and you're so crude and vulgar. Can't you at least read the LRB? So I acceded to her request, and I took out the latest issue, and strange, it was a weird coincidence. One of the lead articles was on Thomas More's Utopia, because this is the 500th year anniversary of the publication of the book. And as a result of the anniversary, there are two new editions of More's Utopia that came out, one from Cambridge University Press and one from Verso Books. And now I'm curious. I ordered both of them today, and I want to see if there is a better modern version than the ones I used. But the class is kind of timely. We are on the 500th anniversary, and when I read that, I felt it was proof of something I've been trying to convince Maren of for many years, namely my prophetic capacity. Prophet? You know, I chose the book, and then it was the 500th anniversary, and nobody seems to be impressed by that fact. So I guess doubt still endures or lingers as to my prophetic quality, but it was... It was reassuring to me. After that, I went to sleep. Now this part, I kid you not, it's going to be recorded, and the person who I'm going to describe now will, I know, watch it at about between 1 or 2 a.m., I'm not sure when, I got a call. You're looking at me like, what's going on here? Give me a chance. It takes time to warm up to me. Right now, you have a very suspicious look in your face. I got a call from somebody, and he said, I was just watching this YouTube of this debate you had with a guy named Mendoza. And I feel he raised some really serious points, that there is a double standard when it comes to Israel and Arabs and blah, 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 and it goes on and on and on. What is going on here? And he went on, made his argument, and I then said, who are you? He said, my name is Oren, my parents are Israeli, and I feel very strongly about this. I said, well, I'm not the kind of person to stand on ceremony, like how dare you call me at this hour, and I don't even know you, and where the heck did you get my telephone number? But don't you think it's inappropriate to call me at this hour? And where did you get my telephone number? And you see, got my telephone number off the web, which is probable. You know, you can find it, you dig hard enough. And he said, well, yeah, maybe you have a point about it being inappropriate, but I really felt strongly about this. Well, far be it from me to stifle a person's intellectual curiosity. And so I told him I was really just a little too groggy to engage that discussion, but we made an appointment to talk about it on Thursday. So it was a strange night. And I do think, aside from my prophetic qualities, it convinces me there's a divine, or at any rate, cosmic force at play, to which none of you care either, which is okay. So, having said that by way of introduction, we now have to meet you folks. So we're going to go around the room, and you can introduce yourself as you choose. So we're going to start with you.
My name is Naomi.
No, insufficient. I understand modesty, but that's too terse.
My name's Naomi. I am an arts administrator at American Ballet Theater.
Well, that's great.
And is that better?
Yes, because it opens up the prospect of free tickets.
So our season starts in May.
May, okay. I'll have to check the web for the calendar for the. I see free tickets on the horizon. Okay, and all right, we'll get to know you more, because the class is about getting to know your, not your pedigree and your credentials, but your brain power.
My name is Isaac. I don't know what else to say. I don't know, I grew up like a few minutes away from here, like down Eastern Parkway.
What high school did you attend?
The Lubavitch Yeshiva here.
Uh-huh.
And
you're blushing. Don't blush.
Nothing to be. Reading and watching your stuff for a while, and was kind of, excited to have the chance to take a class with you.
Well, and I'm happy that you're here.
Thanks.
And that's an honest feeling. So I look forward to our interactions.
Hi, my name is Barry. I'm from Belgium originally. I live in New York for the last 15 years. I come from a Jewish Orthodox community. I'm here right now.
Well, this is very exciting. We're almost 20% of the class is Jewish Orthodox. I'm going to put that on my resume. not that it's going to get me anywhere. Go ahead.
I am Jelle. I'm from Amsterdam. Work as a historian.
Neighbors,
yeah, we can speak Dutch, maybe. I'll only be in town for 2.5 weeks, so I guess I'll sit in on the first three classes, hopefully.
And Yella is an old friend, and he was going through a rough period in his life when I met him, and now he's a very successful graduate student at the European School in Venice, is it called? I've forgotten now the title.
Great class. European University Institute in France.
Uh-huh. And I have a chance occasionally to read his work, and I have to say, very impressive progress from when I first met him. Really impressive show.
Hi, my name's Matt Weiss, from New Jersey, but I live in Brooklyn now. And I'm a writer, poet, with an interest in computer programming and physics, too. And I've been interested in Utopia for a long time. I took a class with Norman last semester. It was wonderful. So for those of you who've never taken a class with him, it's going to be awesome.
Well, you're going to be happy to know that right opposite you, diametrically opposite you, is another physicist. So we have two Orthodox Jews, two physicists. I consider that quite exciting. I mean, it's many points in diversity and free tickets to the ballet.
My name is Miren. I am an Arab American and an atheist, a grandmother and a mother.
What was the last part?
A mother and a grandmother.
Okay. And she supplied me with the London Review of Books and the New York Review of Books.
Hi, my name is Cecilia, West Indian American. My country of birth is Grenada. I attended school in Cyprus, and right now I'm a paralegal. I live in a neighborhood.
And she saw me on January 1st when I went into the ocean for the polar bear day. And I nearly died. My heart was palpitating at a rate that couldn't be measured. And the whole time, Cecilia was laughing.
My name is Abdullah, and I've never read Dostoevsky before. So this will be a first. And I was one of Norman's students more than 20 years ago.
Abdullah was in my class at Brooklyn College, yeah. So it's my first teaching stint. And he then went on to the Columbia Journalism School, and then he spent the last nearly two decades in Egypt. And like Yella, I saw him at the beginning, and then I read a book he wrote on the period which began with the Muslim Brotherhood's presidency in Egypt and climaxed with the coup, the military coup, and Abdullah documented the whole thing as a personal eyewitness in the street. He was there the whole time. And I have to say, the prose in the book was just really impressive. It was a very impressive show. And it's very gratifying to see that people find the capacity and the will to improve themselves in such significant ways. And as I was coming here, I was thinking, I hope Abdullah sits through the whole class, because there's a lot of Dostoevsky that speaks to your life about following your dream, even if it's a rubbishy existence. And you'll resonate to it, you'll see.
Hi, my name is Efrat. I'm Israeli. I moved here 16 something years ago. Secular from Tel Aviv. I used to read Dostoevsky a lot in my bachelor's degree, and I read almost all of it, and then I left it be. So now it's revisiting.
Hi, my name is David. I'm a native Brooklyn boy. Also grew up Orthodox. Grew up immersed in extreme right-wing politics and hyper-capitalism. As a child, I already had conflicts in my head, being religious and talking about ideology, and that was like the main you know, dogma, but realizing the contradictions in community and capitalism. And, you know, I'd say about 8-9 years ago, I discovered, you know, your videos and some other people on YouTube, and I've gotten very interested in the topic, and particularly in relation to Israel. And it's been an exciting education, just going from, you know, one side to the other, and looking forward to learning more.
Well, this is a very unusual class. I'm just wondering how many are spies. No.
Hi, everybody. My name is Cameron.
I wanted to make one comment. I, as Abdullah can tell you, I was never allowed to teach the Israel-Palestine conflict. My professional area has been political theory, and I'm very happy with that. I had no interest in teaching the subject of what I write about, as I find it's not prone to raising interesting questions. It's mostly just expository. This happened, that happened, blah, 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 blah. So we're not going to be discussing Israel-Palestine in this class or any class that I teach. And I'm kind of glad about that. But of course, you're free to bring it in if it's, in your view, relevant. I don't want to disappoint you, and I do want you to stay. But I just want to make clear, because I have a reputation on, say, YouTube, that has no connection with what I taught. I was just teaching political theory in school.
Oh, yeah. So my name is Cameron. People call me Cam, so I'm from Brooklyn. I totally sympathize with you because my specialty in training is international affairs and Middle East affairs, but I don't like that. I like the theory better and the philosophy, and I love dystopias. I love Dostoevsky. I've never read Notes from Underground yet. I've been very involved with the 1984 discussion groups they've been having here at the library, and I encourage anyone to get involved with them because they're loads of fun. That's pretty much it.
Great. So far, nobody has mentioned what they do professionally, so I assume everyone here is unemployed. Oh, no, except you. Which is not surprising, because everybody is unemployed, including me. Just, I realized belatedly.
My name's Carrington. I'm not Israeli.
It's okay.
I'm a WASP, I guess. I'm from Detroit, the Detroit area. And I tried to get into your Plato class last fall, really hard. I couldn't get into it, and I was really disappointed. But so I was happy to see this class here. And do you want to know about what we do for a living?
If you like.
I work for a food and drink magazine.
Food and drink magazine?
Yeah. But I deal with Edible Brooklyn and Edible Manhattan. So I try to deal with, write about food and social justice and handmade things as opposed to factory made things.
Well, if it's edible, I don't care how it's made, just bring it to class.
Okay. For animals, for instance.
What?
Farm raised animals instead of factory raised.
No, animals. Don't bring animals. We okay. Were talking about food. You said food. You know, if you ever get free samples, remember us. Oh, that's a point. You could smuggle it in. We'll turn off the camera.
My name is Michael. Moved in September from Seattle, Washington, to here. I live in Brooklyn, kind of the area. And I work in disability advocacy for Legal Aid Society.
So. He, between last class and this class, he got a job.
Well, between the last course?
Yeah.
Not between Monday and Wednesday.
No.
Yeah. That's true. That's true. I got a job.
Oh, hi, my name is Albert. I'm a college student, but I'm taking a break from school. I was pointing out that I was taking physics, but I actually have a greater interest in philosophy, and I just took physics because I wanted some kind of like basis in science. Underneath, but I think I might change to something else just because of changing interests. Yeah, that's pretty much it.
He's one of those genius types, you know. I know everybody's thinking, yeah, he is. And it's very fun. It's a lot of fun to correspond with you. So I hope you'll keep that up. But maybe not 5 emails each hour. No, that's just a joke. No, I know.
I text incessantly.
You text incessantly?
Yeah.
But incessantly, how would you text incessantly?
Without cease.
Oh, I thought you texted the word incessantly, and I was like, okay, that's nice.
My name is Barry. I write.
Two Barrys.
Okay,
Barry 1 and Barry 2.
My father's name is David, but yeah.
Let me guess, and he went to a Lubavitcher school, and then he went to Israel, now he's secular. No. Okay, got
it. I'm not a wasp. I write poetry, and I'm not formally educated, but I like to read a lot.
That's all you need to do to be formally educated. Actually, my impression is most formally educated people don't read. It's end. It's coming to the end. This may be the last class with the written book. Okay, well, I have to say this class is a surprise. Who would have ever thought? So, I'm welcoming all of you, and I look forward to it. And, you know, if you drop out because you got bored, that's a good reason. But don't get dropped out because it's too hard. I know I've taught a long time, and I taught very difficult works to students who had very minimal backgrounds in college, many of them fresh off the boat. And you struggle, but you get through it. And just feel free to say, I don't understand. And then we're going to patiently go through it together. And sometimes you're going to discover, I don't understand either. Some of it is just very tough, but it shouldn't deter us. Okay, so in terms of I'm not sure of the word, but with our person who's recording it, I think he's asked that we try that when we're speaking, to pass around the microphone, because otherwise it's very difficult on YouTube for people to follow it. So if you can sometimes just get up and walk over to a person, that would be good. And sometimes I'll just try to take you in order as we go around, and then you can just pass the microphone. Okay? Okay, well, let's start and see where we get. I'm afraid I filled you with fear and dread of this text. But I did want to forewarn you, and maybe you'll discover it's not quite as difficult as I have made it out to be. Just one word about the books. There tends to be a kind of turnover the first few weeks and an attrition before we get that hardcore. So what we ask is the first 3 weeks, just the first 3 weeks, you return the book, and then beginning the fourth week, when we're down to the core, the book is yours. That's a courtesy of the library. It becomes your, if we can use the word, because it's problematic in the context of what we're now going to discuss, it becomes your private property. So. Actually, it becomes your private property. You can deprive the whole world of the opportunity to read that text. It's yours. And there are people who do that, and we're going to discuss that with more. It's the problem of pride, people deriving pleasure from other people's lack of things. So you can go around saying, you see, I have a copy of Moore's Utopia, and you don't. And that way, torment, as Moore says it, torment and vex the rest of humanity with the fact that you have this book and they don't. Though I don't think that would torment and vex many people nowadays. Of course, I think many people are tormented and vexed by the fact that they don't have the books I've written. Do you mind if I ask why I see several people laughing? Okay. So, the format of Moore's Utopia is pretty straightforward. It's the story, the way it's laid out is a person makes a voyage somewhere, looks like somewhere in the New World, roughly. He experiences this society called Utopia. Literally, Utopia means nowhere. And then comes back to Europe, engages in a dialogue with several people, including Thomas More himself, and he describes how Utopia functions, how it works. And we're going to look at the questions that are posed, which to my thinking, as I've already said, are as relevant today as they were 500 years ago when the book was first written. The book begins, or I should say, our discussion will begin with Moore's criticism of a system based on private property. Why he thinks a system based on private property is a problem. And as always, we're going to look critically at it. We're not going to accept the criticism. We'll first read it and then see where it leads. Is it accurate? Is it not accurate? And we'll begin with, on page 44, this is the voyager who goes by the name of Raphael. He's talking to Thomas More, and he says at the top of the first indented paragraph, "Howbeit, doubtless, Master More." Who would like to read? Let's start. For those who already know the format, let them begin. So we'll do Efrat. Oh, right, when you read, make sure you have the microphone because it is difficult, and to the best that people can understand it, not looking at it, we want to make it accessible.
Howbeit, doubtless, Master More, to speak truly as my mind giveth me, where possessions be private, where money bereth all the stroke, it is hard and almost impossible that there the well public may justly be governed and prosperously flourish.
Keep going, I'll tell you when to stop.
Okay. Unless you think thus, that justice is there executed where all things come into the hands of evil men, or that prosperity there flourisheth where all is divided among a few, which few, nevertheless, do not lead their lives very wealthily, and the residue live miserably, wretchedly, and beggarly.
Okay. Howbeit, doubtless, Master More, to speak truly as my mind giveth me, to speak honestly, to speak in candor, where possessions be private, where there's private property, where money beareth all the stroke. Anyone want to translate where money beareth all the stroke?
Money is the most important.
Yes, where money is what everybody is seeking, where the profit motive is king, where possessions be private, where money beareth all the stroke, it is hard and almost impossible there that the weal public, the public weal or the public good, it is hard and almost impossible there that the weal public, the public good, may be justly be governed and prosperously flourish. Unless you think that it's for the public good that justice is there executed, where all things come into the hands of evil men. He thinks in a system of private property, it's inevitable that all things come into the hands of evil men, or that prosperity there flourisheth, where all is divided among a few. So he says in a system of private property, it's inevitable that virtually all of the wealth is going to end up in the hands of a few. And he says, unless you think that's prosperity, where only a few possess everything, which few nevertheless do not lead their lives very wealthily, and even the few are unhappy, they don't live their lives very wealthily, they don't live in a prosperous way, and the residue, meaning as the Occupy movement called it, the 99%, or as Bernie Sanders called it, the 99.9%, and the residue live miserably, wretchedly, and beggarly. They're miserable, they're wretched, and they're poor as beggars. Now at the bottom of page, we'll discuss it all, just let's first read it. Let me just see where it goes to. Okay. Somebody who's prepared to read a longer passage, because it's a longer passage, okay. By wise man in this passage, he's actually referring to Plato. For those of you who remember Plato's Republic from last class, Moore leans very heavily on Plato. So those of you who attended that class are at an advantage in this class.
So for the wise men?
Mm-hmm. The wise man here being, again, Plato.
For the wise man did easily foresee this to be the one and only way to the wealth of a commonalty, if equality of all things should be brought in and established. Which, I think, is not possible to be observed where every man's goods be proper and peculiar to himself. For where every man, under certain titles and pretenses, draweth and plucketh to himself as much as he can, so that a few divide among themselves all the whole riches, be there never so much abundance in store, there too the residue is left lack and poverty. And for the most part, it chanceth that this latter sort is more worthy to enjoy that state of wealth than the other be, because the rich men be covetous, crafty, and unprofitable. On the other part, the poor be lowly, simple, and by their daily labor more profitable to the commonwealth than to themselves. Thus, I do fully persuade myself that no equal and just distribution of things can be made, nor that perfect wealth shall ever be among men unless this propriety be exiled and banished. But so long as it shall continue, so long shall remain among the most and best part of men the heavy and inevitable burden of poverty and wretchedness, which, as I grant that it may be somewhat eased, so I utterly deny that it can be wholly taken away. For if there were a statute made that no man should possess above a certain measure of ground, and that no man should have in his stock above a prescript and appointed sum of money, if it were by certain laws decree that neither the king should be of too great power, neither the people too hot and wealthy, and that offices should not be obtained by inordinate suit or by bribes and gifts, that they should neither be bought nor sold, nor that it should be needful for the officers to be at any cost or charge in their offices, for so occasion is given to them by fraud and raven to gather up their money again, and by reason of gifts and bribes the offices be given to rich men, which should rather have been executed by wise men, by such laws, I say, like as sick bodies that be desperate and past cure be wont with continual good cherishing to be kept and botched up for a time, so these evils also might be lightened and mitigated.
but that they may be perfectly cured and brought to a good and upright state, it is not to be hoped for, whilst every man is master of his own to himself. Yea, and whilst you go about to do your cure of one part, you shall make bigger the sore of another part, so the help of one causeth another harm, for as much as nothing can be given to anyone unless it be taken from another.
Okay, it's tough, but don't worry, we're going to get through it. For the wise man, for Plato did easily foresee this to be the one and only way to the wealth of a commonality, if equality of all things should be brought in and stabilized. Plato believed in the equal distribution of wealth, which I think is not possible. You can't have equality where every man's goods be proper and peculiar to himself. You cannot have equality so long as you have private property. For where every man under certain titles and pretenses draweth and plucketh to himself as much as he can, so that a few divide among themselves all the whole riches, even if you have all the abundance in the world, be there never so much abundance and store, there to the residue is left lack and poverty. However much abundance there is in a society, wherever you have private property and private possessions, it just inevitably happens that a handful get everything and the rest are left in lack and poverty. And then he goes on to say that the paradox is the least deserving get the most, and the most deserving get the least. And for the most part, it chanceth that this latter, those who are in lack and poverty, this latter is more worthy to enjoy that state of wealth than the other be. The poor, the ones who lack everything, actually deserve more than those who have everything. Because the rich men, rich people, they're covetous, they're crafty, and they are unprofitable. They're parasites. On the other side, the poor, they're lowly, simple, and by their daily labor, they're more profitable to the commonwealth than to themselves. That is to say, they do more good for society than they get in return in their paychecks, in their salaries, in their material rewards. Thus, I do fully persuade myself that no equal and just distribution of things can be made, nor that perfect wealth shall ever be among men, unless this propriety, this private property, be exiled and banished, unless we get rid of the system of private property, which, as I grant that it may be somewhat eased, but so long as it shall continue, so long shall remain among the most and best part of men the heavy and inevitable burden of poverty and wretchedness. So long as you have a system of private property, the great burdens of society, the wretchedness is going to have to be borne by the majority. And then he goes on to say, now it's true, you can tweak a system. You can reduce the level of inequality. That's possible. And we'll discuss it in a moment. But you can't get rid of these massive inequities in the distribution of wealth, which, as I grant that it may be somewhat eased, you can somewhat reduce the massive inequities of the distribution of wealth, so I utterly deny that it can wholly be taken away. You cannot eliminate it. For if there were a statute made that no man should possess above a certain measure of ground, that no man should have in his stock above a prescribed and appointed sum of money, so even if you pass laws trying to limit the distribution, the maldistribution of wealth. If it were by certain laws decreed that neither the king should be of too great power, neither the people too haughty and wealthy, and that offices should not be obtained by inordinate suit or by bribes and gifts, even if you pass laws like we had in the United States, the campaign finance laws, to make sure that wealth is not unduly determining who gets into office. Even if you do all of that, he says, by such laws, I say, like as sick bodies that be desperate and past cure, be wont with continual good cherishing to be kept and botched up for a time. A sick person, yes, through medicine, through care, you can prolong the person's life, you can reduce the misery. So these evils also might be lightened and mitigated. But that they may be perfectly cured, that you might be able to eliminate this and brought to a good and upright state, it is not to be hoped for. While every man is master to himself, while every person gets to keep as much as he or she has gotten, I don't want to say earned. Yea, and whiles you go about to do your cure of one part, you shall make, well, that's not so important. The idea is clear. And just one other passage before we discuss it. It comes at the very end on page 120 to 121. And it begins here now on page 120. We'll just read part of it. It's a long passage. Who would like to read? By the way, very good readers. Impressive. It's not so easy to read this stuff, by the way. And it's very important that you follow the punctuation. Pause when you see the comma. Just start from how now, here now would I say, see if any man.
Here now would I see if any man dare to be so bold as to compare with this equity for the justice of other nations.
Okay. He's referring to the equity, the fairness of utopia, with what passes for justice in other nations.
Among whom I forsake God, if I can find any sign or token of equity and justice. For what justice is this, that a rich goldsmith or a usurer, or to be short, any of them which either do nothing at all, or else that which they do is such that it is not very necessary to the commonwealth, should have a pleasant and a wealthy living, either by idleness or by unnecessary business, when in the meantime poor laborers, carters, ironsmiths, carpenters, and plowmen, by so great and continual toil, as drawing and bearing beasts be scant able to sustain, and again so necessary toil, that without it no commonwealth were able to continue and endure 1 year, should yet get so hard and poor a living, and live so wretched and miserable a life, that the state and condition of the laboring beasts may seem much better and wealthier, for they be not put to so continual labor, nor their living is
they
not much.
They here is referring to the beasts, for they, go ahead.
Nor their living is not much worse, yea, to them much pleasanter, taking no thought in the mean season for the time to come. But these silly poor wretches be presently tormented with barren and unfruitful labor, and the remembrance of their poor, indigent, and beggarly old age killeth them up. For their daily wages is so little that it will not suffice for the same day, much less it yieldeth any overplus that may daily be laid up for the relief of old age. Is not this an unjust and an unkind public weal, which giveth great fees and rewards to the gentlemen, as they call them, and to goldsmiths and to such other which be either be idle persons or else only flatterers and devisers of vain pleasures? And of the contrary part, maketh no gentle provision for poor plowmen, colliers, laborers, carters, ironsmiths, and carpenters, without whom no commonwealth can continue?
Okay, we'll stop there. I think the idea is pretty clear. And now the question is, how valid is what he's saying? He's making Moore is making three, there are three assertions being made here. The first assertion is pretty straightforward, namely that in any system based on private property, it inevitably happens that wealth gets concentrated in a few hands. You can create legislation which may mitigate those tendencies towards a maldistribution of wealth, but you can't eliminate it. And here I think, at the risk of editorializing, here I think the evidence is pretty clear. And even though Moore wrote this a half millennium ago, 500 years ago, and he doesn't pretend to any kind of statistical proof, it's a kind of what you might call, it's an intuition. It's his sense of what happens in any system based on private property. It's not more than an intuition, but nonetheless, the intuition seems to be borne out by a lot of good statistical evidence. I checked with a friend of mine who's a first-rate economist, and he said the best recent data is in the book by Piketty, who most of you know, some of you know, the book on that's received a lot of public attention on capitalism. And so, what? Doug Hedlund.
Oh, Doug.
Yeah. And so if we look at the first chart, on the handout, the graph is the share of top decile in national income. The top decile just means the top 10% in our society. So the graph basically shows it goes through a fairly nice period, you know, it goes through 100 years, so you have a lot of data here. If you look at 1910, roughly 10% of our society, the top 10%, controlled 40% of the wealth, roughly speaking. Then we go to 1920 to 30, what's sometimes called the Gilded Age. And you can see it's the age of real massive inequality in our society. And as you could see, it goes up to 10% control, about 50% of the wealth. And then if you look further on, the period, say, between 1940 and 1980, or you should say 1942 to 1980, it's roughly the period of the New Deal, the post-war prosperity in our country, the period of what was called the Great Society under Lyndon Johnson, and it all begins to end in 1980 when Reagan is elected. And in that period, 10% control about 30% of the wealth, 35% of the wealth, excuse me. But now, by 2010, as you can see between 2000 and 2010, we have reached the most extreme inequality in the last 100 years. 10% now control 50% of all income. If you turn to the very last chart, I think, yes. Some of you may know that during the Bernie Sanders campaign, probably his most potent pitch to the public was that 1/10 of 1% of our society, 1/10 of 1% control as much wealth as the bottom 90%. It's actually kind of staggering. If you recall, as I mentioned earlier, during the Occupy movement, the slogan was, we are the 99%. But by the time the Bernie Sanders campaign came around, the more appropriate slogan was, we are the 99.9%. Because if you look at the chart, it shows you in A, top wealth groups, and it says the top 0.1%, the third line down. If you go all the way across, the top 0.1%, they control 22% of the wealth. And then if you look down to B, the bottom 90%, which I think includes everyone in this room, I would assume, otherwise I cannot imagine why you would be here. You would be in the Hamptons. The bottom 90% control 22.8% of the wealth. 0.1% control about roughly the same as 90%. I think that's pretty amazing, actually.
And yet we are the happy few.
We're going to get to that. He said, and yet we're the happy few, because Moore does not say we're happy. He does say that the rich are miserable, and we'll get to that. Wealth inequality in the U.S., the second chart, and this goes from 1810 to 2010, so it's about 200 years. And you have, let's say, the top 10%, around 1810, the top 10% control about 60% of the wealth. By 2010, they're controlling about 70% of the wealth. It climbs the highest during what was, as I said, called the Gilded Age, between 1910 and 1920. And then the top 1% controlled about 25% of the wealth in 1810, about 45% of the wealth in 1910, and 2010, the top 1% control about 35% of the wealth. One other chart, if you turn, this is more Yellow's area than mine, but interestingly enough, the inequality, the distribution of wealth is worse in Europe than in the United States. It's not true. Sometimes people say, well, they have social democratic systems, we have uncontrolled capitalism, and theirs is better. No, it's not really true. Wealth and inequality, Europe and the U.S., 1810 to 2010. So the top chart gives you the distribution of wealth in Europe. Again, it's a 200-year period, so you'd have to say that's a reasonable test of Thomas More's intuition. And the top 10% in Europe is actually quite staggering if you look at it. In 1810, the top 10% controlled more than 80% of the wealth. In 1910, the top 10%, this is all Europe, controlled 90% of the wealth. And by 2010, for all the talk about welfare states in Europe and social democracy in Europe, the top 10% control more than 60% of the wealth. The only place where we begin to overtake Europe in inequality, anyone reading the graph can tell us, when do we begin to overtake Europe in inequality?
1960.
Let's see. Yes, roughly around 1960. The second graph with the hollowed out triangles, that's the US distribution of wealth. And begin around 1960, we begin to overtake Europe in terms of inequality. Though it has to be said, not very significantly. You know, you're talking about maybe, a little more than the 5% difference. And those were during the years of the most unrestrained capitalism in the United States. First the Clinton years and then the Bush years. And let's see, the top 1%, we begin to overtake Europe in inequality about 1960 again, yeah. So, not to be a propagandist, but just trying to look at the objective aspect, it would seem that at least you can make the argument that Moore has a case, that wherever you look at this system and however many attempts are made to limit the inequality, it seems to go, it seems to only have a very limited impact. The laws we pass and the governments we elect in trying to reduce the inequality. If you were to have graphs now of China and India, I mean, you wouldn't even have space in the page for the inequalities in places like that. So, that's the first claim. Anyone want to comment? Anyone want to say there's something skewed in this presentation?
Just from the graph, that's because of World War I and World War II, all the wealth was transferred over from Europe to America. I mean, a great deal of wealth was transferred over. So that factors into why there was that big descent.
I couldn't tell you that. I'm listening to you, I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah. I haven't read the text for the tables. Anyone else? Okay, now let's get to the part where we can comment, because we don't, including myself, we don't have the statistical ability really to refute the first part. But now there is a value judgment that Moore makes. There is a kind of objective, factual aspect to his presentation. But then he makes a value judgment. He says, the handful of people who profit from this system are of the worst sort. They're just nasty, covetous, crafty, evil people. And even with all their wealth, they're actually not very happy. So you have two kinds of paradoxes. The system rewards the people which our moral values tell us are the least deserving. If you look at the moral values that are propagated by our society, we're not told to be crafty, devious, and so forth. That's not what we're told. But they're the ones who profit the most. And the second paradox is, for all their profits, they're not very happy. I mean, I'm not saying let's all sit around and feel sorry for the rich, but the fact of the matter is, most of the rich, the wives are cheating on the husbands are cheating on the wives, they're all on drugs, the kids are a mess. They're not really, it's true. They're not really very happy. And, what?
Differs based on the
individual. Well, you think it differs on the individual, depends on the individual. Moore says that's not really true. It's the nature of the system. There's something, as I said to you, he doesn't attempt to prove it sociologically. It's both an intuition. Also, he's a very learned man. So it's from having studied, read literature, interacting with people.
What did he study? In terms of like at his time.
Wait, let me just, I want to just get the whole proposition out and then we can talk. And he says, the rest of us, we live impoverished, miserable existences. And the paradox is there that we make the most contribution to society. It's like the school teacher. The school teacher gets paid so little in our society, and yet the school teachers, your grade school teacher, I could still name all my grade school teachers. I have a vivid recollection of each and every one of them. They were your surrogate parents and your first teachers, and yet they are live basically very poor existences. I think in our New York now, a school teacher starts out with like $45,000 a year, if I'm not mistaken. And that leaves aside the 10,000 people each day who make our lives bearable and who are compensated so miserably by our society, whether it's the porter in your building or the offhand, it's just all the people you see in the street now, New York, mostly Mexicans. The people who work in your fruit and vegetable stands, your supermarkets, everybody around you, they're the ones who make life actually livable, and they get compensated so wretchedly and miserably by our society. Is that correct? What do you think? I'll go around. You want to just bring over the, and then I'm going to let the people. Don't feel obliged to be politically correct. You can just say, I kind of think rich people are the nicest people on earth, and I don't think teachers deserve more than they get. Most of them are pretty lazy and not very smart. You can say that.
I don't think that.
I mean, if you want to say that and humiliate yourself in front of the whole world, it's okay.
No. I don't think that. I do agree that there's some value judgments that are askew in who contributes a lot to our society, like the teachers you're saying. And I do think that there are a lot of blind spots that people have when they have a lot of wealth, when they look around and see kind of how, who is working hard to make things run.
Well, you realize most of the patrons of your organization are the rich parasites that Moore is talking about. They're the ones who attend the ballet pretending to be cultured, and they're crafty, devious, vicious. Are you willing to say that in the public? Do you think you'll have a job?
It's being recorded.
You could pass the microphone.
Yeah, professionally, I'm not going to comment.
Do you think Moore is exaggerating? I mean, he's painting a very stark picture, and there's this debate, if you read the literature on books like Moore's, about whether he's really meant to be taken literally or he's being facetious. I kind of think he's meant to be taken literally. We had this debate last class with whether Plato was to be taken literally. I thought he was. In many ways, Moore sounds here like just a kind of communist propagandist. It's almost embarrassing to read it. But it is Thomas Moore. The book is a classic. And I do think it's meant to be taken literally. Do you think it is exaggerated?
I think a lot of the broad strokes resonate with me. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think
have you ever met a rich person who you liked?
Yes.
You did?
Yes. Yes.
Have you ever met a rich person who you think got by his riches or her riches honestly?
I think yes, they they got them honestly, but I do also think they were had some very fortunate circumstances available to them.
Mm-hmm. It also depends on how you make your money.
Go ahead. Wait, well, let's go ahead. What do you think, Mr. Isaac? You can choose any aspect of the question. Let me just play, as I like to do, the devil's advocate. And let's say the following. First of all, the standard argument, as you of course know, because everybody in this room knows, is, well, these people create jobs, and they are enterprising, and they are, they show ingenuity, they show energy, they're energetic, and that they are being both, they are being rewarded according to the contribution they make. And secondly, they give back a lot to society. They create the jobs. They invent the things that make our society thrive. And that in the passage we read from Moore, which I can assure you I was not selective in my choice of passages, he doesn't acknowledge any of that. The rich, he says, they're lazy, they don't do anything, but in fact, they work very hard and they're very energetic, and they give back to society much more than they take. They give us the jobs. They give us the dynamism of our system. Hasn't Moore lost complete sight of that? Go ahead. Or any other aspect, you would like to focus on?
I'm kind of drawing a blank. It is a lot to think about, but I'm not sure what I can pinpoint.
Well, let's start with the first basic propositions. Is it true that the handful who profit from our system are the worst sort of people and they're unhappy? Is that true?
I don't know.
No, you must have an opinion. You must have one rich relative. I mean, you don't have to name the person.
No, I'll tell you, you kind of gave it a very good, you know, the two sides of the coin in your description just now. It does seem that there are a lot of, you know, you think of Wall Street as a group, and you kind of get Moore's description fits them better. That's mm-hmm. kind of a group of people that, you know, sit at screens and do a lot of financial manipulations that kind of pulls out a lot of value and, you know, puts it in their pocket, doesn't really do anything for society, and it really maybe comes at the expense of the other classes of people who actually work and contribute and do things that we'll benefit from. But on the other hand, it does seem that there are, you know, like maybe some other class of people who, you know, and maybe also like the nature of capitalism, there does seem to be some kind of natural aspect to it where you kind of take capital, you put it at risk, you can lose it, you can profit, sometimes you do, sometimes you can become very wealthy through that. And
have you met rich people who you like?
That's a good question. I'd have to think about that. You know, I don't know, not really.
Have you met rich people who are happy? Everybody on Wall Street's on cocaine. That's just common knowledge. They're all on drugs.
Yeah, and it's surprising to hear Moore have that same, you know, sense of things that far back.
Yeah, it is surprising to read 500 years ago they were saying things like this. Yeah, it was a surprise to me, actually.
Right.
What do you say, Barry?
It's actually a very interesting subject for me because I see it more as I do know a lot of rich people. And it's more for me a question as facts. It's not what I read or what I watched.
Okay, and so what is your personal experience?
You're right.
It's not me.
No, I'm saying what the book says.
Yeah.
They're not happy. But there are the people who are, there are certain individuals who get it. And I look on them to be pretty lucky because they do have the wealth and they know how to do things right with it.
And honestly, don't be politically correct.
No, absolutely not.
Who do you think, honestly speaking, who contributes more to society? a Wall Street hedge fund manager or a second grade school teacher? And I'm curious, that's what Moore is saying. He said the poor contribute more to society than they get in return. They walk home with nothing. They can barely survive. In our society nowadays, about, you know, it's kind of astonishing if you look at the statistics of the average person 50 years old in our society has no savings, not a penny, not one penny, no savings at all. They live from paycheck to paycheck. And I know I'm speaking though from friends, and quite a number of my friends are hurting. Young people, quite a lot of them are, you know, former students, they're still living at home in their 30s. People my age, one of them is a nurse. She complains a lot, and she's very smart. She complains a lot about money. You know, to the point, I can't really come visit you because the gas from New Jersey to here is too much. She's the kindest person on God's earth. Bar none, kindest person on God's earth. She's a nurse in a public school. What could be a more generous profession? She could have been a medical doctor. She chose and she became a nurse. What could be a more generous profession? And she's hurting, exactly as Moore says. Is that accurate, though, as a generalization? Or are most poor people, they're rewarded according to their, we're told they're rewarded according to their ability. They didn't really contribute all that much. They weren't all that smart in school. And okay, they're nice, they're sweet, but it ain't much. And they get back what they give. Whereas Mark Zuckerberg and all these other people, they created Facebook and Amazon and created these huge enterprises, and they get back in return for their creativity, their ingenuity, and their effort. What do you think? Go ahead.
Good question. I'm not sure what to answer, because it's, from one way you can see it, even a thing like Amazon, what he created, it's something that a lot of people can have use out of it, and created a station for people to grow and have opportunities. But from the other side, like you said, the simple nurse or teacher, the nicest people around, and they do so much for society. And they don't have money to pay for their, just to get over the bridge.
What do you say, Yella? Do you think Moore is exaggerating? Is he missing a critical part of the picture?
No, I don't think he's missing any critical part of the picture. In terms of defenses of rich people's contribution to society, I mean, I think most critiques nowadays would focus more on the most people in society, you know, even sort of liberals would agree with critiques of the 1% of people who are almost always born wealthy. So someone like Mark Zuckerberg, I don't know his background, but he seems to be an exception.
He wasn't born
wealthy. No, so he's yeah, so he would be an exception, but, you know, as also Piketty shows in his books, most people in that top 1% are born wealthy. But there are many more arguments that people give for, let's say, the top 10% of people who invested in themselves, who put in time in college, took out student debt, and so on and so forth, and therefore also deserve higher rewards later in life.
I see, he says maybe there's 1% whose wealth is basically hereditary, and they have no claim to having earned it by virtue of hard work or enterprise. It's just, you know, Trump got his father's real estate business, and he, at some points, he ran it into the ground, and at other points, made it successful, but certainly he didn't start off, you know, from rags to riches. But Yella says, if you look at the bigger category of, say, the 10%, well, I have to say, my friends from high school, they all turned out, I mean, successful beyond human imagination. They are all top of their field, but I also have to say they were very smart, very smart, and they were ambitious to the point that you felt revulsion. No, I'm serious. I mean, the level of ambition, they were not nice people. You know Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, beware the lean and hungry look. They all had the lean and hungry look. The ambition, they were going to be the top, and nothing was going to stand in their way. I'm not going to say they didn't work hard, they worked hard. And I'm not going to say it was luck or heredity, it was not. They were smart, no question about it. But really nasty people. I'm not going to, I'll see one side which I feel more leaves out, but I'm not going to pretend these are nice people. No way on God's earth.
Maybe let me add to that for me as well. I mean, you've asked people, have you met any nice rich people? I don't know. I've maybe met one very wealthy person in my life, but in the higher up.
Yeah, I'm not that rich. No.
I wasn't talking about you. but in my professional life now, I'm working in academia, and now that the higher up I get, you know, all kinds of people have been, you know, the top schools in the world. I notice it, you know, these are nasty people. I mean, in order to get there, I've also had to make compromises with myself in order to get there. Everyone that I know has to make compromises in the way they treat other people, in the way they are there for friends or not, in the way what they spend their time on.
Yeah, I know, because somebody, an important, a famous professor once went up to Yella and said, do you know Norman Finkelstein? He said, oh, who?
Never done that.
What do you think, Matt?
I think it's a tough issue. I mean, I've known some rich people who've been nice to me, but I was not a threat to them. So I mean,
that's the point. They'll be nice to you if you're not a threat. Well, not necessarily. They can be nasty also.
I mean, I could play devil's advocate for a second and be like, well, you know, if you start from a premise like, you know, humans respond to like incentives, and another premise that we need, our society needs to innovate technologically as fast as possible because we don't know an asteroid's gonna come hit the Earth, anything could happen, we need to like, you know, have a backup plan for the human race. Then, you know, take an example like computers, you know, like decades ago, they cost like tens of thousands of dollars, and it's precisely the rich who can afford them, and thus, you know, there's an incentive to do that kind of research, and also an incentive to lower the price so that more and more people can buy them. And so you see this sort of like, you know, capitalist development where precisely because there's wealth inequality, eventually something like an iPhone can like be in everyone's pocket, which might be necessary to save humanity from a dark and foreboding abyss, you know, that is like the universe. And so, you know, from the like, you know, to care about, you know, the simple artisan, the grocer, these people are important, but, you know, from the perspective of the year 3000, you know, it's like, is it really going to make a difference? At the same time, if, you know, society were organized along a more like rationalist or like socialist lines, then you could probably have the technological innovation without the hardship. So I don't think that necessarily, but I do know that people, capitalists, have been known to argue along those lines.
Marin, the rich men be covetous, crafty, and unprofitable. The poor be lowly, simple, and by their daily labor more profitable to the commonwealth than to themselves. Does that sound like your rich friends?
I don't have rich friends, number one. While I was listening to the text, spontaneously, I agreed. But I also thought of two things. One of my philosophy professors used to say, the minute you say 17th century philosophers are, stop, you are wrong. It is a category. You can't put all philosophers. You haven't read each one of them. You cannot make such a sweeping judgment. It's like when we hear today Muslims instead of Muslim are 1,600,000,000 Muslims, and yet Muslims are. So it's...
Right, but I have to disagree on this point, Marin.
Yes.
The object of sociology is you want to make certain valid generalizations because we all generalize. Generalizing is part of a functioning in life. We have to have generalizations, otherwise we couldn't function. When it says 60% chance of rain, it means in these particular weather conditions, 60% of the time it rains, and then we take an umbrella. We're acting on the basis of a generalization, and you have to generalize. And the question is, of course, not every last person, but as a generalization, is it a valid depiction of our society, or is it a caricature? A caricature would then be, no, it just goes way beyond a valid generalization, and it now verges on the terrain of a caricature, and it's unacceptable. Or even worse than the caricature, it becomes propaganda, and it's not really serious. So which category would you put these generalizations in? In the category of a fair generalization, a caricature, or just downright propaganda?
Frankly, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
I have no way of knowing.
Well, it's an
especially in his time. And you always, you rely on facts every time you speak, every time you write. Hmm. And what do we rely on? We just believe what
he
said.
But,
his impression, his ideas.
You have life experience. And remember, a lot of what Moore was saying was based on intuition. He couldn't prove, so to speak, that what I'm saying is based on the laws of capitalism. He doesn't make any pretense to that. He's making a inference based on broad reading, broad knowledge, and broad experience. And so you have broad reading, you have broad knowledge, and you have broad experience. Does it resonate for you what he's saying?
Yes, I started by saying I tend to agree with him. Yes, it does. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And what about the argument that people in our society, they effectively get what they deserve, and they return to society on the basis of the contribution they have been rewarded for? Do you accept that or not?
No.
Why not?
I don't know. Why not? Because from what I see around me, my experience is that they don't. You are given, but you don't give back in general. This has been my experience.
What do you say, Celia? You grew up in Grenada, you went to school in Cyprus, and now you live in New York. So you've had lots of life experience. Do you think his generalizations are valid?
Well, I approach it from the context of capitalism, from American history, specifically Black history. America was built on the backs of slaves for almost 500 years. They gave their very blood and they got nothing in return. And unlike what Ben Carson said, they weren't immigrants. Well, Molly,
I don't understand some of these things these people are saying. I know it's a diversion, but I really, it's just, why did he have to say they were African Americans were immigrants? Why did he have to do that?
I think
it's horrible, but Obama said the same several times.
That African Americans were immigrants?
No.
Yeah.
No.
Like, actually, if you like follow like the right wing pundits, you've been like sharing that all over the place. I mean, the way Obama like.
We're not going to get distracted, but you're going to tell me later, and you'll email me. I'm okay.
It kind of behooves me when an American of African ancestry gets to sit at the table of the white man that he totally whitewashed history. I mean, it's like my son will say, it's asinine, it's unacceptable. If Blacks were brought to this country as immigrants, he was saying to me this evening, then Harriet Tubman, she is a tow conductor, you know, a tow operator.
An engineer, yeah.
But the fact that...
That's actually a funny line. Does everyone understand? Harriet Tubman was organized what was called the Underground Railroad to help African Americans in the South to escape from slavery. So she said if African Americans were, as Ben Carson said, immigrants, then Harriet Tubman was a subway engineer, a token booth operator. Or that was funny.
You know, so in terms of capitalism, Black Americans always playing catch up, you know, because you just cannot close the...
I want to be devil's advocate. Celia,
yes.
Aren't there a lot of poor people who are just lazy?
I know a lot of poor people who are just lazy, too.
Yeah, so crafty and devious, figuring out ways to make money, pretending to be poor and panhandling, they don't want to work. I met a guy like that the other week.
Well, he
says, I like the panhandle, I like the acting.
I mean, if you live in New York and you use the subway or even walk the streets, you know, everybody has, you know, some trying a way to, you know.
But are all the poor, like he says, lowly, simple, and by their daily labor more profitable to the Commonwealth than to themselves? Is that really an accurate generalization of poor people?
I would think so, because you just last week they were saying that the undocumented aliens that they contribute almost, I think it was $40 billion to New York economy. But these are the people, because they do not have their papers, they cannot access, you know, social services. So they work in the shadows, they give their very all, they're like the modern day slaves, but they get nothing in return.
I'm not going to joke about that, because I think that's true. There's some things I'll joke about, but that one, there are just too many Mexicans in New York who are in exactly that situation.
And for public education, the teachers, I didn't attend school here at the elementary or the secondary level, but my son, and I had to take him out from public school because they just weren't giving him what he wanted. And at college, when I, you know, read American history, public education at the beginning, it worked when it was basically geared solely towards Europeans. But when it came to the others, the brown, the yellow, the black, and the red, it just didn't deliver. Because at the college level, the kids come to school and they're not prepared. But they will tell you we were valedictorians. We got all A's. It just doesn't deliver for the others. You know, so I had to take him out and put him in a private school. Then he was like, oh, Mom, could you teach me? I said, but I can't believe it. You're an American. It just doesn't deliver. The promise is not there for them. Education is not that gateway to that, you know, to that bright future where they could be contributing members of society. They're undereducated.
Abdullah? Now, Abdullah lived in Egypt, where the disparities in wealth make the United States look like utopia. And you must have had crossed paths with many a very rich Egyptian. So, what do you think, and many poor, including yourself, for quite a long period in Egypt. So when you read more, does it sound right to you, wrong to you, exaggerated to you, what?
I definitely agree with more on wealthy people. And I think very few of the wealthy people have, I think, in my opinion, earned their wealth through honor or honorable means. And a lot of people have earned their wealth either because they were monopolists or they had close relationships with the government or government officials and they can get import license. Or because they were involved in arms trading or drug dealing. And there was only the very small percentage that you can say earned their wealth honorably. You know, people like Steve Jobs or people like Mark Zuckerberg who built something that became very successful. But aside from that, it's usually not the most honorable who become the wealthiest.
What about the argument that this is all sour grapes? The failures in society.
Have your attention, please. Central Library will be closing in 15 minutes. If you have any reference materials to return, please do so at this time. If you would like to check out any materials, please join the checkout line now. Okay. I repeat, Central Library will be closing in 15 minutes.
What about the argument that it's all sour grapes, that the people who failed are trying to disparage the rich, are envious of them, jealous of them, and it's just the failures complaining. How do you react to that?
I think there's just the general American myth that just the opposite, that works just the opposite, that I can be just like them, I can be wealthy just like them. And that's what gets people to play the lottery, even though their chances of winning are just so small. But it's the myth that you can be one like them, and somehow you don't want this inequality to be bridged because you want to get to the other side one day.
What about my mother used to say, okay, money can't buy happiness, but she said it can't hurt either. So she was perfectly happy trying to be rich. But now Moore says the rich are the unhappiest of all. Is that true? Unhappy in the Hamptons. Unhappy in their condos. Unhappy vacationing all around the world. Should we tell poor people, don't bother trying to be rich because you're going to be unhappy anyway? Should we tell them that? Or is it like kind of easy to say it's unhappy being rich? I kind of think it would be nice if you can pay your bills at the end of the month. That's the kind of unhappiness I would be very happy to get rid of. So isn't that partly also, you know, the rich, yeah, maybe they're unhappy, but they also have it damn good. And most people would rightfully want to exchange places with them.
I think they're unhappy for different reasons. They're unhappy because they see someone who's wealthier than them, or they're unhappy because they're getting old and the plastic surgeon didn't do a good job to fix their nose. You know, whatever, you know, the things that would obsess, you know, people who where money is not a concern. Maybe I think it could make them happier because if you had all the money in the world.
Okay, I'm telling you. You were very poor, I can tell you. there were periods, I'll say it now because you're out of it, but there were periods where Abdullah didn't eat for 2 or 3 days, I remember. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah.
He literally couldn't eat such because he was determined to make it as a journalist, and it was very tough. Now, your sister, his sister went to Stuyvesant, was it?
Yeah.
Very successful. She's a physician now. Wouldn't you want to exchange your unhappiness for hers?
Not really, because even, you know, in the moments, I want to give other people a chance to speak too, but in, even in the moments that I didn't have very much, I can tell you that there was always other people who were ton times worse off than me, so it didn't even seem that I should be complaining. And because it, I was living in a poor country, but even if I was living in a poor country, I had the privilege of getting a good education. I had the privilege of even flying in a plane. Just that something that simple, lots of people, you know, wouldn't ever experience it, no matter how long they lived. So there was always that idea that, look, I, however bad things might seem to me, you know, lots of other people, millions, billions of other people have it.
But wouldn't you exchange, would you exchange the unhappiness of the rich for the unhappiness that you experienced?
Well, it's...
I'm saying that there's something...
Have your attention, please. Mm-hmm. Central Library will be closing in 10 minutes.
We have 5 more minutes and then we'll walk out. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Would I exchange the happiness of the rich?
Yeah. Or is there something wrong with describing them as unhappy because it's a very rarefied, elevated form of unhappiness that they're experiencing?
But I think it's also the choices that everyone makes. You know, that either if someone's mission is to make lots of money, then that's maybe what they will do. You know, instead of being a nurse or a teacher, they'll work on Wall Street and they will, you know, work the ranks and, you know, move up the ranks and make the alliances that they need to and have the ambition that they need to have so that they can make the money that they dream of having. And it's a choice that people make. And if money is their objective, they'll find a way to make it, even if it's through illegal means.
Okay, we only have like 2 minutes. Does anyone here have something they want to say?
I just had a question. Where did Moore get this idea of, you know, how it's kind of in that communal property would be, people would be happier? Like
that's what we're going, that's going to be the whole book. This is just the beginning, his criticism of a system based on private property. And then the remainder of the book is going to be why he thinks a system based on common ownership will be a happier society. And
but was there an old civilization at that era that was living with communal property?
Well, he's going to claim Utopia did.
Right, but I'm...
Well, we'll see, because the arguments can be evaluated. I could see he wants us. Okay, so if you don't mind, just return the books, and we'll see each other next week. Why?
Time passed faster than I thought.
Life passes faster than I thought.